Uvalde police literally twiddling their thumbs, absolutely doing nothing while children are being killed inside of a school. 77 minutes, these cops did not do a damn thing to help these children. In the midst of that, you had a mother who ran inside of that school. You had another police officer whose wife was shot and dying. He tries to get inside, they end up arresting him. And parents were threatened with being arrested themselves for telling the cops, go in and do something. We got the video now. All right, let's go to when the shooter entered the school. You see what's happening. Here's how the officers responded when they knew what was going down. Those cowards are why so many children died that day. Those cowards. We're going to expose all of it, every bit of it. Now, isn't it ironic how the police will act when they think someone has a gun, as opposed to when they know they have one? 77 minute video, recording captured from this vantage point, along with body camera footage from one of the responding officers obtained by the American Statesman and KVUE, shows in excruciating detail dozens of sworn officers, local, state, and federal, heavily armed. They had on body armor, helmets, some even had protective shields, walking back and forth in the hallway, some leaving the camera frame and then reappearing, others training their weapons toward the classroom, talking, making cell phone calls, sending texts, and looking at floor plans, but not entering or even attempting to enter the classroom. Let's put up some of the pictures of the police from that day. Even after they heard four additional shots from the classroom, 45 minutes after they arrived, guess what they did? You're looking at them, they did nothing. They had means to do something, but did not. They asked for keys. They said, okay, we need keys to a classroom. So they literally asked for keys of the classrooms. It was unlocked, investigators said later. They brought tear gas and gas mask. They later carried a sledgehammer, and still they waited and did nothing. I don't think they ever wanted to go inside of that classroom. I think they made up a story and said, we're going to say we were waiting on the key. The door wasn't even locked. You see, they did not believe the scrutiny that has visited this particular area would come this way. I don't think they ever believed we would get this much granular detail about what happened that day. When have you ever known a cop to wait on a damn key to go get somebody? There's more. Officers finally rushed into the classroom and killed the gunman an hour and 14 minutes after police first arrived on the scene. 19 fourth graders and their two teachers died in the massacre on May 24th, days before the end of the school year. Let's put up the picture of the Texas Department of Public Safety Director Steve McCraw on the left. The man on the right, School District Police Chief Pete Arredondo, the incident commander. Now, McCraw has been very critical of the commander and Uvalde police in general. Arredondo treated the situation as a barricaded subject, which calls for a slower methodical response, according to the report, not an active shooter situation, in which police are charged with doing anything possible to stop a gunman, including putting their own lives on the line. That was a mistake, McCraw said. Now, here's the thing. The commander did not even have radio communication with all of law enforcement. They were communicating in various ways. It was a ridiculous scene. Everyone heard the gunshots. If there's a bad call on the ground, there's somebody else in charge. You got a sergeant, you got somebody else. Who can say, I don't give a damn what the captain says or the chief says. This is an active shooter situation, unless you're scared. Now, if you're afraid, you're not going to say that. You're just going to say, oh, you know what? Chief said, this is not an active shooter situation. Even though they actively hear someone shooting, children crying, adults screaming. McCraw has singled out Chief Arredondo for blame in restraining officers from going in earlier than they did. I disagree with McGraw. I blame all of them. But the video shows multiple responding agencies on the scene, including officers from the Uvalde Police Department, Uvalde County Sheriff's Department, Texas Department of Public Safety, Texas Rangers, US Border Patrol, and the US Marshal Services. They were all there. That's why they didn't want you to see that video. They were all there and all complicit in the death of those children. There's outrage, obviously, now from individuals who are watching this, seeing it, sharing it on social media. Here are some of the responses. Sophie Ross says, the guy who stopped for hand sanitizer also had time to check his cell phone. Just doing anything other than attempting to save the screaming children down the hallway. Senator Nina Turner said, cops in Uvalde checked their phones and got hand sanitizer while children were massacred. My God. Since the shooting, the families of the victims have been begging local and state officials for transparency on what happened. This is a start. Now we know it wasn't just one police agency. Now we know it wasn't just one particular person, as McGraw wanted us to believe. We know that this was a failure from top to bottom. This is cultural. The policy is right. The policy says, here's what you do. Well, there's an active shooter. But as I've said before, culture will eat policy alive any day. All right. Doctor, I got to ask you, because you being a psychiatrist, sir, I'm not disciplined in your arena. I see a bunch of cowards. I see scared men when children are being killed. You can't tell me command is so strong that no one broke rank, even though parents broke rank, other cops broke rank when they heard that their family were inside, but none of these cops broke rank. I don't understand, Doc.
Well, first, my God, is that hard to watch? I mean, knowing what's happening, knowing what those sounds mean, it's like watching a scene from a, you know, a war zone, really, which is what parts of America have become. And so part of the issue is just the human tragedy of this inaction and also what's happening, where those gunshots are coming from. No matter how many times you watch it and think about it, it's just a pathology on so many American levels, right? The gun, the shooter, and then the response. Clearly, as you're saying, and I completely agree, this was a massive failure. There were many more guns on the outside of that room than there were on the inside of that room. Maybe they thought there was some negotiation that was gonna happen, but I think I agree with you that the police acted like humans. They felt like they were outgunned, and it just seems pretty clear that it was a terrifying situation. They were afraid. And I say that in part because, having studied mass shootings, there are a number of other mass shootings, including many high profile ones, where police act the same way. We've had shootings in mass shootings in Florida, in Illinois, same kind of story, where the cops show up with guns and then they don't want to die, or they feel like they're outgunned by the shooter. And so I agree with you, we need better policies, but let's think about what that policy might mean. Do we want the cops to have more powerful guns than the shooter? Do we want them to act more aggressively? I think it's a complicated question, right? It's a complicated question. And I think one that really, I mean, I hope we learn from this. I hope better policies come from this particular issue. But I would also say that the problem is certainly of the police, but it's also the problem of just having those kind of weapons in America, and the police feeling like they're outgunned in situations like this. So just, I mean, I'm having a very emotional response to this, obviously, yeah, because I think it's so powerful and so searing.
I will say this about those that actually did save lives. The young woman, the mother, who was arrested trying to get inside of that building, she then is able to get out of the handcuffs, flees from law enforcement, jumps the fence, gets into the school, finds her children, gets them out, and saves other children. She had no combat training. She had no police backup. She had no artillery. She had no ammunition, but what she had was heart. And she did not have a culture that says, I'm afraid to sacrifice myself. So I get it, Doc. There's a conversation policy-wise, but there's also a conversation about what kind of cops are we hiring today? Because put those cops in a different situation, I guarantee you they're gonna act like Billy Badass, like they're the most untouchable person in the world. And then you put them in a real situation like that, where you gotta man up and do something. You saw exactly what happened on that video.